know you're aware that you have 15 minutes in which to present your case. We are being visually and audibly recorded and posted online, so please try to remain behind the podium as much as possible. And we have read your brief, so we're ready to proceed when you are.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. My name is Lindsay Rubel, and I'm one of the attorneys for the plaintiff appellant in this case, the Townhomes at French Creek Reserve Homeowners Association. In this particular association, there are 92 owners who have, for the past 3 years, been paying their dues fairly regularly. This particular matter came about when the defendant, Christopher Woods, who is a unit owner at the townhomes, failed to rectify his non-payment of dues that occurred approximately 3 years ago. The other owners at the association have been making up Mr. Woods' shortfall for this period of time. And specifically, I'm here on this case to ensure that the townhomes owners have their budget rectified. The impact of a case like this may be far-reaching amongst condominium and homeowners associations in our area as well as in the state of Ohio. Homeowners associations are not creditors by choice. The intent is that the homeowners association will adopt a budget every year that's adopted by the Board of Trustees, and that every month the owners will pay their monthly maintenance assessments to cover those common expenses. If the monthly assessments are not paid, then the balance will start to accrue, and in this particular case, the townhomes at French Creek has a policy that says if an owner does not pay on time, they will incur a late payment charge of $25, and also if they carry over a balance from the prior month, that there will also be a $25 late charge if there isn't a continuing unpaid balance. This means that for an unpaid delinquent owner, the balance continues to mount each month if the balance has not been paid in full from the prior month. So oftentimes, our office will get a case like this that's a simple missed non-payment, and we will try everything in our power to get to that owner before we get to the point of litigation. We'll send numerous demand letters, and our goal always is to avoid foreclosure actions because that's very costly to the association, and honestly, a lot of the board members don't want to be ousting their fellow neighbors out of their homes for non-payment of association fees. There is a statutory right to recovery of reasonable attorney fees for homeowners associations under Revised Code 5312. And in this particular case, the trial court found that although Mr. Woods was delinquent in the payment of his assessments, the association was not entitled to any attorney fees whatsoever, and only a single late fee and insufficient funds fee. So the reason I'm before you today, this particular board has decided that in future cases where we have delinquencies, they're afraid that they're going to be throwing good money after bad. If they file a small claims case and cannot recover any of their late fees and any of their attorney fees. So in this particular situation, the trial court's decision has put them in a position where either we'll ignore delinquencies or we'll wait until the point of foreclosure. So the first assignment of error that I will address is whether the trial court erred in failing to award late fees, and that's continuing late fees to the Homeowners Association, except for a single late fee for the April 2015 payment. In this particular case, as I stated, French Creek does have a collection policy that states that late fees shall accrue on the unpaid balance and on any late payment. In this particular case, there was a late payment in April of 2015, which was the result of an automatic debit that the association had been performing in order for Mr. Woods to pay his maintenance fees.
Excuse me, counsel. You said yes. You had a policy. This was the policy of Town Homes at French Creek.
Yes, Your Honor.
Was that policy contained in a handbook or something that Mr. Woods was provided with when he decided to build or purchase?
Yes, Your Honor. There is a policy, a handbook of rules and regulations that every owner of record is given at the time they purchase at the townhomes of French Creek. And that handbook has a section in it entitled collection policy. And that policy within it contains the late fee provision that states that late fee shall accrue on.
Thank you.
Thank you. And that was an exhibit to the trial. I believe it was exhibit C, if I'm not mistaken, and it was provided to the trial court judge. On April 10th of 2015, when the association attempted to withdraw the maintenance fee, it was returned for insufficient funds. One of the statements contained within the judgment entry by the trial court judge was that the association should have gone back in and attempted multiple times to re-withdraw this amount. The association's policy, however, is we only attempt one withdrawal, and if it's returned for insufficient funds, then we move on to the next month. So in this particular case, this concerns a homeowners association, but a lot of times these condominium cases are very similar in facts and nature. So there are some condominium cases that provide guidance on these sorts of issues. In the case of Olentangy versus Lusk, a condominium owner failed to make the monthly payment each month. So there was an assessment. The owner made some payment, but didn't make full payment of the monthly maintenance fee each month. In that particular case, this was out of the 10th District, the trial court found that monthly late fees were still warranted and that the court upheld the association's right to charge a late fee on an unpaid balance. We also have a similar case, which is actually out of Texas, which I understand does not have the same statutory framework as Ohio, but this is the case of Forest Point Venture versus Forest Point Homeowners Association. And this was regarding the application of payments, which is very similar to Ohio's payment application statute. In that case, the court said that the practice of the association to credit fees first toward late fees and then toward the attorney fees and lastly to the maintenance fees was not void against public policy. And further, that the relationship between the association and a owner was not meant to be creditor-debtor. The association's intent was never to be a creditor. It was to manage the finances of the association, but not actually to extend that credit. So any late fees on a continuing basis would not be deemed usurious, provided that they were reasonable in relation to the amount that was due. In this particular case, the monthly late fees are $25 per month, and the monthly fee for the townhomes ranges from $185 to $215 per month. Your Honors, the second issue that's before the court today is whether the trial court erred when failing to award any attorney fees at all to the association. The trial court's entry states that although the defendant failed to make that April 2015 payment and the association was entitled to judgment of the assessment, judgment for a $25 late fee, and judgment for an insufficient funds charge of $15, that although the association was entitled to judgment, that any attorney fees in this case would be patently unreasonable. The review of attorney fees is examined under an abuse of discretion standard. In the trial court's analysis, there is no reference to the hourly rate charged by the association, the total time spent on the matter, whether the total charge was reasonable as to the time spent for the intricacy of the work. In this particular case, actually, while I understand the court is not here to make this determination as to reasonableness of the total attorney fees, the association paid our office $575 for about 7.5 hours of legal work, which amounts to about $75 an hour. And that includes the time that was spent on the small claims case as well.
What did you present to the court as far as attorney's fees go?
Your Honor, we presented an itemization of the attorney fees that were spent on the case. So that started with the very commencement of the case, where we sent a collection letter by certified mail to the owner, and it ends with the small claims. Oftentimes, in these small claims cases, we just charge a flat rate of $325. That way, the association has some sort of definiteness with their budget, so that amount would have been billed in advance of the hearing, regardless of how much time was spent in preparing or attending the hearing.
In reviewing the judgment entry, I'm confused as to whether he only missed one payment, and then like the April payment was missed, and did he continue to make payments after April?
He continued to make payments after April, correct.
So the non-payment for the April, or the insufficient funds fee, the $15, was charged one time because it was...
Yes.
And then the $25 late fee for April was charged.
Was charged,
and
yes.
That late fee for April was charged 22 additional times?
Yes, there was a late fee on the unpaid balance because that April 2015 payment was never rectified.
So your contention is that it continued to be late for 22 additional months, and he was charged $25 for 22 additional months?
Correct, Your Honor. Yes.
And he never paid that April?
He's never paid it, and the issue here is, he's received monthly statements from the association. Our office has tried to contact him numerous times, and this is the only way we could reasonably tell our clients this is how you should handle.
How was the May payment made? By the debit from his account, as all the previous accounts had been?
Yes, Your Honor, it was.
So he's never really written a check to pay anything. It's always just been debited from his account.
That's correct, yes.
But it was never, they never attempted to debit his account for the April payment after the first time?
No, that's correct, Your Honor. And the issue here is we feel that it's getting into a slippery slope if we're going to continually attempt to withdraw funds from an owner's account without their authorization, because the form they sign says we'll do a single monthly debit of this amount. So the question becomes, if there's an enforcement assessment, do we then take that as well? So it's a slippery slope in our opinion.
Does the agreement that you're contending that everybody who resides there is under, and if the $25 fee is in there, is there something in it that says that it's a cumulative $25 or something? It's not just a one-time $25 fee, but for every month you're late thereafter, we're going to compound that $25. Is there something in it that says that? Because it seems kind of odd.
Well, and this is actually, in terms of a collection policy for an association who has a monthly maintenance fee, it does say that the late fee shall accrue on the unpaid balance, and monthly late fee shall accrue on the unpaid balance and on any late payment. So it specifically states that if there's an unpaid balance, there will be also be a monthly late fee on that amount.
So the payment that was withdrawn from his account in May wasn't credited back for April?
No. Well, it was technically, in accordance with Revised Code 5312.11b, it would have been credited first to any late fees on the account and then to any attorney fees. So theoretically, the May payment would have been credited first to the late fee and then a partial credit toward his April assessment.
Did anybody ever attempt to mediate this case at all?
I can tell you, Your Honor, that all of my attempts at contacting Mr. Woods have gone unnoticed. They've been unresponsive. He hasn't responded to any of the maintenance fee statements. And this is one of our last resorts, is
to file a case like this. But in, you know, it's one of those situations when a board comes to me and asks, well, how should we handle this case? He hasn't paid, you know, this is just one fee from last year. You know, if everybody were to be in that position in the association where they just didn't pay 1 month and never rectified it, how would we ever recover if we can't go to small claims court? And the association cannot represent itself, unfortunately. And so they're forced to pay my bill, and we try to make it as reasonable as possible. But that presents this issue. If there are partial payments, you know, and there, we do have that statutory right to recover late fees. If there's no award whatsoever for attorney fees, that's been said that shocks the conscience, and that we have this case of Olentangy versus Lust, again, where the association was just seeking a $2,000 award, and the attorney fees were around $23,000, and the court said the attorney fees should not be a multiple of the damage award. It should be based on the time spent, the hourly rate, the total fees charged.
With that, you have reached the end of your time. We thank you for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement and issue a written decision, which will be mailed to both sides and posted to our website as well as at the Supreme Court.
Thank you for your time today, Your Honor.